Morning to you, man. Morning to your love. Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me young ones, who are we today? Yeah, now. Well, Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me young ones, who are we today?
The black oasis, ancient Africa, the sacred awaken, the sleeping giant, science, art is your creation. I dreamt that we could visit old Kemet. Your history is too complex and rigid for some Western critics. They want the whole subject diminished, but Africa's the origin of all the world's religions. We praise bridges that carried us over the battlefronts of Sudanic soldiers, the task put before us.
You hear me out? Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me young ones, who are we today? Yeah, now. Well, Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me young ones, who are we today?
Who are we today? The slums, diseases, AIDS, we need that all to fade. We cannot be afraid. So who are we today? We are the morning after, the makeshift youth, the slave ship captured. Our diaspora is the final chapter. The ancestral lineage built pyramids. America's first immigrant, the king's son and daughters from now waters. The first architect, the first philosophers, astronomers, the first prophets and the doctors was us.
Hey, now can we all pray? Each in his own way, teaching and learning, we can work it out. We love a warm bed, we love some warm bread and shelter from the storm dread, and we can work it out. Mother Nature feeds all in famine and drought. Tell those selfish in ways not to share us out. What's a tree without root? Lion without tooth? Lie without truth, you hear me out. Africa must wake up, you sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. They start every working, can you tell me young ones, who are we today? Yeah, Lord. Well, Africa must wake up, you sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may some more love come. They start every working, I tell you young blood, this world is yours today.
Let it go, daddy, why it never defeated? On inky torte pizza, why didn't get the ire? On the maquila piso, why didn't get the shade? On the hot linky dum eye, why didn't get the head? Let it go, daddy, why it never defeated? On inky torte pizza, why didn't get the ire? On the maquila piso, why didn't get the shade?
Relatives. So that's why we came together.
together. One of the reasons myself and Damien came together, 'cause we all come from one place, and that's Africa. That's right, you too, and you, the whole world. We all family. We just spread out all over the place. So to all my distant relatives, let's take it back home.
I said, well, Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob. For what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Is that every working? Can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Well, Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob. For what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Is that every working? Can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Who are we today? Morning to you, morning to you, man. Morning to you, love.
If I can explain this, man. People want to know, you know, about God, Family, Nation. Is it an organization? No. Is it something you can join? Nah. God, Family, Nation is a way of life.
First, God made the family. Family made the nation. Take this concept and embrace it. Let's see how far we can take it. We can make it to the other side to see our brothers rise, receive the prize and the love that comes in the mother's eyes. Z-I-O-N. Can I go in? What I'm asking my Messiah on judgment when my life ends. It's GFN. From my soul to my skin, from young to old men, how many souls can we win? This been the mission, the word of God is my equipment. This song, the hook, so if you listening, then I'm fishing. Make your decision, I hope to God that we get it. I'm speaking to my people, have my partners think I'm tripping. His grace sufficient, just having faith can make the difference. Take it day by day and be consistent. Self-examination, patience, praying while we waiting. GFN is more than just a statement. It's God, Family, Nation.
It's God, Family, Nation.
Yeah,
it's God, Family, Nation. It's God, Family, Nation.
Shalom. What's going on? How y'all doing out there? We are your brothers from God, Family, Nation, and we here for another podcast, for our weekly podcast. And today we have a interesting topic today. We're gonna be talking about the Bantus today. We got some guests on here. We're gonna have another guest show up soon, most high willing. And we're gonna talk it in tonight about who's the Bantu Israelites in Africa. All right, we're gonna be talking about it. We're gonna be going in, and y'all bear with me. I'm Brother Palau, I'll be y'all host for the day. I'm actually filling in for Brother Ra'ai and Brother Corey. And as a co-host today, I got Brother Anaya. Introduce yourself, my brother.
Shalom, everybody. Shalom. How y'all doing out there? We got a real good podcast for y'all tonight. It should be edifying.
Already. And I'm gonna just introduce everybody else on the panel tonight. We got Agbanaya on here. Introduce yourself to the people, my brother.
Shalom, everybody. I'm Brother Banaya. I'm in Tanzania. And yeah, Shalom. Hopefully we have a pretty good and edifying podcast today.
Definitely. Most high willing. Then we got Brother Adam Wong. We got Brother Kerry over here. Introduce yourself to the people, my brother.
All right, I'm Brother Adewale, and I'm here in Tanzania, and hey, you know, I'm here. I'm happy to be here on the platform.
All praise to the Most High. All praise. Then we got another brother in Tanzania, Brother Mayan. Shalom, brother, you can introduce yourself to the listeners.
What's going on, man?
Shalom. All right, tonight we're gonna have an interesting podcast. I'm gonna jump into it, you know. So we're gonna be talking about the Bantu. We're talking about Bantus, who the Bantu Israelites in Africa. You know, why is it important for us to talk about these people? Because we are in the last days, and it's part of the gospel to identify who the children of Israel is. It's part of the gospel. You know, it's part of the gospel. And also, Brother Ron Dalton just joined. If you can introduce yourself to the people, to the listeners out there, Brother Ron Dalton.
All right. My name is Ron Dalton, the author of the book, Hebrews to Negroes, Wake Up Black America, and the movies. The first movie was Hebrews to Negroes, Wake Up Black America. And I got some other movies too that came after that. And I formerly was in Babylon, America. And I left early of this year to South Africa. But prior to that, we have been to Ghana with about 30 to 40 Hebrews during the Beyond the Return festival in Cape Coast in Accra. And then shortly after that, they issued the mandates, the mandatory mandates. And after the president did that, I said, no, thank you, sir. I'm not waiting around. And looked into South Africa. And so I'm here. Okay. I'm here. But people probably know me from YouTube and Instagram. On YouTube, I go by the name Hebrews to Negroes. TV, aka Moses Levi, and then on Instagram it's Hebrews_TO_Negroes.
All right, cool.
That's about it.
Yeah, definitely good to have you on the show, man. You know, I know we was facing, you know, the power outages. You know, us out here living in Africa, that happens very often out here, man. But Most High willing, we're going to get into this information, man. We're going to get into enlighten our people about the Bantu, about who they is in these times, you know, and what's you know, we got to get into it. I'm going to, before I go into interview you, you know, before I go into it, I want to bring something out real quick. And, you know, and you can piggyback on it if you want to and everything. But this right here, I got this Bible right here. It's called the African Heritage Bible. Okay, the African Heritage Bible. And I'm gonna read a couple of commentaries out of here from this Bible. All right. The first one I'm gonna read is from Leviticus chapter 10, verse 10. And the commentary is dealing with the holy and the unholy. I'm gonna read this, and it says, Such practices has been common throughout all Africa. For instance, Ashanti women were restricted to the Bara hut during the menstruation. The Ashanti also established a system of absolution to prevent legal uncleanliness. Okay, this is just showing how the Ashanti people, you know, have the traditions of the unclean and cleanliness that's written in Leviticus. All right, and keeping this custom even till today. And I'm gonna read another one. All right, this is off Leviticus chapter 23. All right, dealing with first fruits. All right, and it say, when the ancient African Hebrews harvested the first crops of the season, the first fruits of their harvest was sacrificed to the Most High God. This is an African practice even to this day among such tribes as the Akamba, that's a Bantu tribe out here in Kenya, and the Kikuyu, it's another Bantu tribe out here in Kenya, out here in East Africa. All right, so it's letting you know that when we're dealing with the first fruits, it's written in Leviticus 23, they actually, some of these Bantus, they still keeping some of these biblical traditions even to today. All right. And I talked to Kikuyus. I'm out here in Kenya. I talked to Kikuyus, and what I just read about first fruits, they call that, actually it's called Mageta. They call that Mageta. Okay. So I just want to bring that out, man. We're going to be, you know, just going into it, man. You know, so Brother Ron, let's get into it, man. Let's get into it. So the first thing I want to ask you, tell me about South Africa. Yo, you know what I'm saying? Tell me about how it is out there, man. Tell the people, tell the world, you know, about South Africa.
It's nice. It's freedom, it's peace. There's more Black people here than Gentiles, even though Gentiles are here. The South African Bantu, the Zulu, the Xhosa, the Pedi, the Swana, the Soto, the Swati, the Tsonga, the Venda, and other tribes, Mbo, they're all here. And you have others from Zambia and Congo and Nigeria. Angola, Mozambique this year as well. It's a little bit different than Ghana, but ultimately, you know, they're all Bantu, primarily a stock, genetic stock, and they have a history. Of course, many people know about Shaka Zulu, but prior to Shaka Zulu, a lot of the history of the South African Bantu stems from their migration from the Congo region. But, you know, you see a lot of the history and a lot of the cultural practices when you go to the village and when they have like festivals and different things of that nature. But South Africa is a lot of modernization going on here in Johannesburg, Cape Town. So a lot of what the people here do, they get a lot of it from America. So it's a lot of influence from America over here in South Africa. You know, just like the shows, the TV shows, the movies, the music that they watch, that we watch over here in America, they watch it too. And so they're familiar with all the music that we listen to in the 90s and the 80s. 2000, they're familiar with all these songs. They can recite it word for word, and they're actually, we have more in common with them than we think. You know, I found that out, and a lot of the oppression that they had in apartheid, we experienced similar things in America with Jim Crow and segregation and the Gentiles telling us where we can go, where we can't go. But, you know, there's still a level of oppression here in South Africa that the Gentiles have here, even though they're the minority. And, you know, it's just a matter of us being educated down here and then creating some unity unity and awareness is the key to taking back what is rightfully yours and to rising up to the position that you're supposed to be in. You know, that's ultimately what needs to happen here in Africa, so that Africa is not being, you know, misused like a prostitute.
Okay, I got you. So, you know, well, let me ask you, if I want you to go into some information about how do you know that the Zulu and the Bantu tribes out there in South Africa are the children of Israel? Go into some details about, you know, and then your interaction with them and just witnessing certain things, be like, wow, that's scriptural. You know, just tell me about it.
Well, one of the things is that they have the South African Bantu have the same DNA markers on the father's side that other Bantu people have, such as the Igbo, the Yoruba, the Kikongo, the Ashanti, the Fanti, the Ebe, the Ga, the Kikuyu, the Kamba, the Abagusi, the Luya. They all have the same DNA. And so you can't have somebody over here saying that we're the Israelites, and then they have the same DNA as you, and you say, no, I'm a Cushite. You know, that's like my brother saying he's a Cushite, or my cousin saying he's a Cushite, and I'm an Israelite. Yeah, but we have the same DNA, we have the same forefather, and it shows in our DNA. But in terms of the customs, some tribes do have some Hebrew, I would call it evidence in their language. But in terms of the traditions and customs, you know, circumcision is a big rite of passage. Cleanliness laws, you know, when you're on your menses, and then for you're unclean for a period of 7 days. On the eighth day, you're considered clean. And same thing with childbirth. Same thing with when somebody dies in the family, then the whole family that's immediate to the person that died, they're considered unclean. And they have to go through a cleansing ceremony that they have to do before they're considered clean again. And things like going to the mountain to pray, to have fast, to have intercession with God, to have festivals, fringes, the shofar. I mean, they got shofars down here, even though they blow them to the side like that. And then, you know, it's... The first fruits, you know, like I was talking to a brother from the Zulu tribe, and he was saying how the first fruits of the harvest, they give it to God before anybody eats, you know, before anybody partakes in it. And so just listening to the people that's knowledgeable about their traditions and customs, you start to see elements of their practices in the Old Testament. Now, whether they know or not that their practices are from the Torah, if you're an Israelite and you've been studying the Bible, then you're going to automatically pick it up and say, ah, that's in the Bible, you know. And you might even tell them, like, hey, that's in the Bible. You know that? And they might say, oh, yes, you know. And you might even be able to quote the book, chapter, verse that it's in to confirm that you guys are the Israelites, whether you knew it or not. So asking the people specific things on like what is considered clean and unclean in terms of food. Back in the old days, what did you guys eat? What you couldn't eat? Because down here, you might see people eating pig and pork. They got grocery stores that have, they got more pork than they do beef. But I mean, they have beef, they have goat, they have lamb. But you ask the elders, you say, hey, back in the old days, did you guys eat the pig? And they'll say, no, nah, we didn't eat that. And I say, why? He said, because it was an unclean animal. And I say, yeah, it is a dirty animal. You know, it'll eat anything. And he's like, oh, yeah, but there's certain things we couldn't eat back in the day. But now things have changed and people are eating, you know, all types of stuff, you know. But they know the traditions of what they were allowed to eat, what they were not allowed to eat, you know, back in the ancient times, you know, like hundreds of years ago before a white man came here. So, and then, you know, then a lot of them will even say that we left out of Egypt. Well, Moses or the Exodus. It's like an Exodus story in how they migrated south. They don't necessarily say they migrated to northeast, northeast like modern day Israel. They will say we migrated south. we left Egypt when we came down south. So, you know, they may not tell you the whole history, like, oh yeah, we were invaded by the Syrians and the Babylonians, and we went through this and that. They're not going to give you a play-by-play history of the Old Testament, you know, as it is in our Bible, but based on the DNA, based on the language, based on the traditions and customs, based on a matter of exclusion, we know that they're not the Cushites, we know that they're not the Canaanites, we know that they're not the Egyptians, the Putzites, we know they're not the children of Japheth. Then, you know, who are these people down here in sub-Saharan Africa that are circumcising, that are keeping a lot of the Torah customs still intact before they even had the white men come and bring Christianity with the Bible? They already doing this through oral history, oral traditions.
Okay, yeah, I mean.
I wanted to say something real.
Yeah, go ahead.
My bad. Mm-hmm. No, I was just saying, so like, it's kind of like you can draw that conclusion based off like a lot of circumstantial evidence, right? And you mentioned something about Shaka Zulu and how he was in basically South Africa. And you know, one thing about movies, although a lot of times there's a lot of garbage in it, it actually be a lot of facts in movies too, because like I know, and I'm sure a lot of people familiar with this now, but when you go back and you watch Shaka Zulu, when they were speaking about him, they said that he had the other Bantus in that area or other quote unquote Africans in that area running from him, basically how they were running from the enemies during 70 AD or whatever, like the Wandering Jews of Africa is what they call them. So basically alluding to the fact that, you know, that those people down there in those, you know, interiors of Africa, a lot of them actually are Bantus, otherwise known as Israelites.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Mm-hmm. That is true. That's interesting, man. Very interesting. I'm gonna read something real quick, and then I'm gonna ask you another question, Brother Dalton. So I'm gonna read this out of the Zondervan Bible Dictionary, because you had made a point. So I'm gonna read Ham, which we are probably familiar with this. Ham, the youngest son of Noah, born probably about 96 years before the flood, and one of the 8 persons to live through the flood, he became the progenitor of the dark races. Not the Negroes, but the Egyptians, the Ethiopians, the Libyans, and the Canaanites. So if these Bantus are not Ethiopians, these Bantus are not Egyptians, these Bantus are not Canaanites, these Bantus are not put on the original Libyans and all that. So who are these people? Who are these people? So I want to ask you, Brother Dalton, can you explain to the listeners, what is a Bantu? What is a Bantu?
The word, okay, so the singular word for a person is Muntu, M-U-N-T-U. And then plural is Bantu or a Bantu. Bantu down in South Africa can be seen as derogatory to some people because that's what the white man used to call the people down here. They call them Bantu, and they kind of flip the word to make it mean something that's negative, even though the word Bantu is a Niger-Congo Bantu word. You know, we see people using it in the Congo, in East Africa, in South Africa. So they rather prefer a Bantu. And it means the people. And even though it can mean the like a people, like a group of people standing over there, it's specifically designed to mean the people of the Most High or the people like you know, the Israelites, you know. Because essentially the Bantu people are very large in number. And they stretch from, people will say East Africa, Central Africa, South Africa, but in terms of the DNA of the Bantu people, in reality, the Bantu people, if they are an ethnic group, then they're also in West Africa too, because they share the same DNA as the Yoruba and the Igbo and the Fon and the Ewe and the Ga and the Shanti and the Fanti and the Bamale, all these different tribes. You know, I could just keep naming off the list. And they all are branched under the scientific name, or the white man's name would be the Niger-Congo languages, Niger-Congo A, B, and they have different branches. But ultimately, they'll also use the word Bantu people, the Bantu languages. So This is referring to a people that are different than the African Pygmies. They're different than the Khoisan. They're different, the Bushmen. They're different than the Somalians, the Tuaregs, the Fulani, the Hausa, the Beja, the Afars, the Burana, you know, the Nilots, like the Dinka, the Anahuac, the Shilluk, the Nuer, you know, all these different tribes, the Masalit, the Fur. They're different than them. And they differ in a lot of things, their tradition, their customs, their language, their old histories, their DNA. It's a lot of things that separates them from these other ethnic groups in Africa. And the Bantu people really, you know, if you go down to the DNA, DNA for DNA, they are the most numerous people in all of Africa, to be honest with you, you know, because the white Arabs in the north, they are they have a mixture of different DNA haplogroups. So they are heterogeneous people. They're a heterogeneous people, meaning that they don't typically have one particular Y DNA, like say like the Dinka do in South Sudan. You know, the Dinka and the Nilots in South Sudan, they all look the same, and they all, most of them are tall. They're dark. They haven't had a lot of mixture with other races or other nations. And therefore, they have pretty much the same Y DNA when they get their DNA tested. Same thing with the Pygmies, but with the Bantu people, they, because of the practice of polygamy, and just the fact that they are they multiply, you know, a lot. They have dominated the continent of Africa in terms of population, in terms of their specific ethnic group.
Okay, interesting. So. I want to ask you this. Trying to transition to your book. Can you tell the listeners about your book, about the Hebrews to Negroes? Can you elaborate on your book and tell it, like, what was the thought process behind it, and how did you come to put it together and everything? Just explain it to the people about your book and your documentary, your movie.
Well, the book was inspired by me. One day I was in church and I was reading Deuteronomy 28. And after I read the whole chapter, you know, I started asking myself, I said, this doesn't sound like the Jews that we think, that we see on the streets and on Saturdays. And I said, this to me reminds me of Black people and the history of Black people in America. And so that's when I started asking God to show me the truth about you know, these curses of Israel seem like they're talking about us, but yet we're being told in church we're Gentiles. And the pastor didn't want to, you know, address this. So I just asked God, you know, at the time I said, God, just to, you know, show me the truth. And when he did, like a flood of information and me just going like a madman, crazy in terms of the researching and connecting all the dots. And when I had done all this, including researching in regards to the adversary or the enemy and those in high places, brotherhoods, secret societies, you know, occults and secret clubs, I started saying, this is what it's all about. This is why we're in this predicament. This is why the world is the way it is. And so when I originally got this information, I was trying to teach this to my congregation that I was a part of in the Christian church, but they didn't want to hear it. So I said, well, I can't have all this information in folders and on my computer, on notebooks. I said, I got to get this out somehow. I'm not a book author. I'm just a guy that went to college and, you know, was working at the time. And I said, how else do people learn this information if I can't teach it to them, you know, at a class or something? So I just started typing all this out on, you know, on Microsoft Word, and it ended up being like 1,000 pages. And then I cut it down to 700, and that was book one. And then I did book two, and then book three, and book four. And so all four books is geared around, you know, proving and explaining the things that we weren't taught in the Christian church in regards to who are the Canaanites, who are the Cushites, who are the Egyptians, who are the Puttites, who are the Ishmaelites, who are the Edomites, who are the Israelites, and who are the people today that we know as Jews, you know, who are they? You know, the Ashkenazis, the Fardic Mizrahi, the Ethiopian Jews, the Lemba Jews, and the Crystal of Israel, who's the fit? And some, you know, I started to delve into the religion of comedic science, you know, debunking that, Islam and Catholic Church, Roman Catholic Church, Catholicism, and all these other, I guess you'll call them teachings that are common in the Black community, like the Five Percenters, the Moors, people that believe that, oh, the Sabaeans, the Anunnaki people, you know, the indigenous Indians. You know, I had to you know, kind of debunk all of these things because Black people are coming from an area where you don't know what type of background that they have. You might have some Black people that are reading the book that are Moors, or their yeah. uncles are Moor, you know, or they're in the Nation of Islam, or they're following Brother Polite and Sanetter and these Egyptian guys. So you have to address all of these to get them to say, you know, this is right. Like Ron's just exposed what we believe to be true. Now that I know it's garbage, now let's get into some truth. And the truth in the books that I wrote, in the movies, is a lot. It's a lot to handle. And when you truly digest it and understand it, I don't think any rational person that's using critical thinking and logic can actually read my books and watch the movies and even follow my videos and the lessons on H2N TV and still say, nah, we're the Egyptians. Nah, we're the indigenous Indians of the Americas. We're the Moors and all sorts of, you can't do that. You just at that moment, you're rejecting truth. You're rejecting straight truth. And you want to believe your convenient lie because you just don't want to believe that somebody else is right and you're wrong.
Okay, interesting. And you know, everybody that's listening, if y'all haven't checked out his book, check it out, you know, read it, check out his documentary, look at it. You know, he bring out some real good information. Now, before we transition to the brothers in Tanzania, because I'm going to ask the brothers in Tanzania some questions, because a lot of people don't understand, like, when they hear Israelites in Africa, they think of West Africa, you know what I'm saying, for the most part. But they don't realize that East Africa is full of Jews. It's full of Jews over there in East Africa, you know, just as much as it is in West Africa. And you know what I'm saying? So in East Africa and in South Africa, there's so many Jews there, you know. And since we foots on the ground in these locations, you know, it's important for the people to hear our perspective on what we'll be bringing forth. So the last question I want you before we go into some other things is what's your future plans when it comes? Can you tell the listeners some about your future plans for the Bantu people in Africa, or for any future projects that you may have, anything like that?
the future plans is to wake up the Bantu people in Africa, wake them up to their identity, wake up the dry bones, start getting people talking about it, so they can see that he's my brother. You know, just because he's Xhosa and Zulu don't mean we're different people. The languages are basically the same. You know, the Nguni languages are similar. And, you know, the white man, he came, he divided the land so that you got Zimbabwe, Mozambique, Botswana, Namibia, Lesotho, Swazi, South Africa, you know, and you got tribes that are living on other sides of the border, but they're being told that you can't stay here. You got to leave and go back to Zimbabwe, you know, or Mozambique, but you guys are speaking the same dialect. You know, I had a brother, two guys came to my house to deliver some food, and they were talking to each other. And I said, y'all understand each other's language? I said, where are you from? He said, Zimbabwe. What tribe? And then he said, the tribe. And this brother said he was from this tribe in South Africa. I said, but y'all talking to each other? He was like, yeah, the language is basically the same. I said, but y'all live in two different countries and speak two different supposedly dialects and come from two different tribes. And he said, well, yeah, we're basically the same people, but we were divided. The boundary lines was divided. And because of that, you know, I'm Zimbabwean, you're South African. And because of this, we have xenophobia in South Africa. Oh, we got to get the Zimbabweans out of here because they're taking all the jobs. We got to get the Kikongo and the Baluba and the Bemba and all these different Zambians and Nigerians. We got to get them out of here because they're taking all the jobs and they're not us and blah, blah, blah. At the end of the day, we have to understand that our biggest enemy is ourself. We have the colonized, but our biggest enemy is us, because we're just a hard-headed people. We're stiff-necked people that don't realize that you guys are, if you're 90% of the population in South Africa, then why is it that these other nations are running the private sector? Why are they running the show? Why they got your foot? Why they got their foot on your neck? And they got all the good jobs, the good positions. They're living in paradise. They're walking around at ease and at rest, and with no worries, no cares in the world, but everybody else is struggling to survive. There are people are facing unemployment. And you know, it's we gotta start waking up, and we gotta understand that unity is the most powerful thing that we have. And that the things that is stopping us from being unified is us to understand our common identity and our common ancestral forefather. And with that, what was prophesied about us, the past, present, and the future. And if we align ourselves with our biblical destiny, you know, now we know who we are, then we should know exactly what we need to do. So in Africa, you know, I'm planning on, you know, doing some movie screenings, showing the movie Hebrews to Negroes. I've been passing out flyers since I've been here. I've been spreading the word. You know, I got my books out here, trying to get the books into the bookstores out here. And every person I meet in Uber or out, connecting them with my Instagram page and YouTube, and because they don't know about you know, the Israelite movement in America. Exactly. There's not a lot of African American diaspora here in South Africa. They might come and visit, but then they leave, and it's only a small handful of people here from the South African diaspora, and a lot of them that are here, they're not Hebraic mindset. So the ones that are here, they're just here. Chilling and, you know, affiliating themselves with each other, the locals, and that's it. You know, it's just like, you know, live your life and then get old and die in South Africa in the motherland. You escaped America, but at the end of the day, there's a bigger task at hand. We're living in the last days, and people need to understand that we cannot fulfill the last days unless we also fulfill Ezekiel 38, I mean Ezekiel 37, and the dry bones prophecy. And all the prophecies that states the things that were supposed to happen in terms of the children of Israel. And all the Israelites are not in the Americas, in the Caribbean. We have to get that clear. The people have to understand that the majority of the Israelites bulk worldwide, especially if you're talking about the so-called Negro, you have to go to Africa. You cannot find the Israelites, the 12 tribes, just by going to the Americas. You have to get back to the continent of Africa to really, you know, piece all the pieces of the puzzle together. So with myself and other Hebrews that are here in South Africa, that have a community mindset, and we have a mission and a goal, our goal is to, of course, be more self-sustainable and not dependent on the system, but at the same token, educate the locals and those in the area of who we are, and try to stir up a lot of talk and a lot of meetings and coming together so that we can all start to use the population advantage that we have in South Africa to spread this information to across the airways. You know, if 80 to 90% of the people here are Bantu, then the majority of people that's working in the radio show, the radio stations, the podcasts, the movies, distribution, production, marketing, advertising, digital marketing, all these things, these are people that are Bantu, that are working behind the scenes in these organizations and different fields. So all we need is a voice. All we need is a platform. Just like if somebody gets on the Breakfast Club, he's a no-name artist, you know, and he gets in a Breakfast Club like the baby, you know, he has a documentary on Netflix. Get in front of the Breakfast Club. Breakfast Club has like millions of listeners. Once you get in front of the Breakfast Club, you start talking about your album, your movie, what you're doing, now people are going to be like, huh, who's this guy? You know, they're like, you know, and so in Africa, if we can just penetrate the mass media and the podcasts and the radio stations and the movie theater and whatever way we can, social media lights that have millions of followers, because they got South Africans here that have millions of followers on Instagram and YouTube. We just got to get them to start talking about this Israelite awakening and spread the word so that people can start, you know, not just thinking when you go to church that it's all about looking at white Jesus and the pastor telling you we're all equal, you know, God is love, you know, bless all the poor because their reward is in heaven. And also, you know, they got, instead of listening to the white pastors and pastors that are still asleep, we have to start educating them on the other reasons why these things are happening to the continent of Africa, because it then starts making sense and then they start to wake up. And so here I am in Africa trying to wake up the people just like I did in America. And trust me, in Africa, there's a lot of waking up that needs to be done.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, it's cool. I mean, a lot of people is if you really want to do the work, go to Africa. You know what I'm saying? I just put it like that. If you really want to do the work, you really want to, because there's still more work to do. It's so much work to do. You know what I'm saying? Right now, so much work to do. You know what I'm saying? And I believe that Africa is the next focus point on this work when it comes to waking up our people, giving back the true identity, giving the true gospel of Christ. You know, I believe, you know, Africa will be the next focus point. You know what I'm saying? And if you ain't with it, you got to get in where you fit in, because it's plenty places to fit in Africa to get the work in. it's enough space in Africa to get the work in. You know, we just got to network. I agree with you saying we got to network, come together, you know, reach these media platforms out here in Africa, because we able to do it because we come in with American resources. So we able to do it. You know what I'm saying? People really need to really hear what you're saying, because it's important. It's so much work to do in Africa, and I can't stress that enough. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, awesome. I did the first radio show I did here. The South African radio host, he kept trying to revert the conversation to George Floyd, slavery, Jim Crow, racism. Why would you want to come here? You guys, you're a first world country. You know, you guys have a lot of opportunities. You know, you can get to the top. You know, you look at Will Smith, look at, you know, LeBron James, look at Jay-Z, look at these people, Oprah Winfrey. Why would you want to come here? And they kept going, trying to switch the narrative back to America, America, America. And I was trying to keep it on a Hebrew identity thing, you know, and I was trying to give the history of the Bantu people and of the so-called Negro that was taken on a slave ship from West Africa and Central Africa to the Americas, and how we are connected to even those in South Africa and East Africa, even though we weren't part of the Arab slave trade. And, you know, we weren't, the transatlantic slave trade didn't, you know, have slave ports in Cape Town or Cape of Good Coast. And the guy was, you know, he wasn't feeling it. He wasn't getting it. He kept bringing me back to America, Jay-Z, oppression, slavery, civil rights, and all this stuff, and, you know, Black Lives Matter. And I said, I don't want to talk. I mean, yes, that's going on in America, but I don't want to talk about that right now. I want to talk about, you know, how we are connected. We are one. We are one people. And this is a time right now that is critical. You know, I was trying to tell them about the way the world is moving, and everything I was saying was facts. You know, about the economy, about, you know, the digitalization, AI. You know, all this is happening right now, and, you know, and how it's important that people in Africa wake up, because this is the breadbasket. This is the breadbasket of the world. This is the so-called Garden of Eden. This is the place that is going to sustain a lot of people. When we really have a great tribulation, you know, this is going to be a place to be if you really want to be self-sustainable, because America you know, 99% of Americans depend on the grocery store. And we all know that in America, you miss those property tax payments and your land is gone, your house is gone. You know, you can kiss it goodbye. You know, so America is a trap, you know, and Africa is freedom. We just got to utilize the land for what it was designed for us to do in the end times. But, you know, I did the show. Those that heard a little bit, I was trying to push, maybe a light bulb boop, went off. But, you know, you just got to keep pounding hard when you get these radio interviews and not be scared to tell people we're the Israelites. You know, like when Tiffany Haddish and other people go on the Breakfast Club, they start saying we're the real Jew and the Jews were black like us, like even Floyd Mayweather. But they stopped after a while, and DJ Envy and Charlamagne and Angela Yee, usually when somebody's saying something about we're the real Jews and the Jews are black, they usually sit there. They don't say anything. They don't ask any questions. They just sit there. Oh, okay. And then they go to another subject. You know, almost like, you know, this is a weird moment that you even brought that up. And okay, let's go on to something else. So, but in Africa, it's a little different because we can kind of freely speak our mind and keep it black and keep it focused on who we are, why we're here, and all of us need to unite. We're all one people.
I agree with you, man. Go ahead, Anaya.
My bad. I just wanted to read something real quick. I also wanted to let Brother Ron Delta know that I'm a good actor. So, you know, when you start your movie, you need a star role. You know, I'm your guy.
Okay. All right.
I got you. But I just wanted to read the scripture real quick to support what y'all are saying about, you know, one of the best places to go is within the interiors of Africa, even according to the scriptures, right? That's where we're supposed to go at, especially if you're coming from the Western world. Because I'm going to read it. It's Jeremiah 50, and I'm going to start at verse 4. It says, in those days and in that time, saith the Lord, the children of Israel shall come, they and the children of Judah together, going and weeping, they shall go and seek the Lord their God. They shall ask the way to Zion with their faces thitherward, saying, come and let us join ourselves to the Lord in a perpetual covenant that shall not be forgotten. So for those of us that's in the Western Hemisphere, we know for a fact that the only way you get into Jerusalem is by going to the Eastern Hemisphere. So eventually we're going to have to come together as a people and make our way into that area. And in order to get into that area, you got to go through Africa either way. Africa is a checkpoint. You have to go through Africa. So while you're seeking refuge from the Most High and seeking refuge from the Lord, to go into Israel, you might as well do the work of the Most High on the way there, which is in Africa. That's where the majority of our people is at, just like y'all stated.
Exactly. Any other questions y'all want to ask Brother Ron, before we move on to the Tanzania questions? Any of y'all brothers, any of y'all?
I want to ask Brother Ron, first of all, you know, saying it's a blessing to be on the platform with you. And thank you for taking the time, you know, to do this podcast with us, you know. But according to your research and everything that you gathered together with, as much as possible, the data that you gathered together, how long would you say that our people have before they should actually totally vacate America? And I know it's just an estimate, but just, you know, give us a good time frame based on what's going on and what you see getting ready to happen in the near future.
I think we have 5 years or less, and that's just being gracious, because, you know, there in America, they're controlling the food, the water, the way that you are able to get food. You gotta have money. They gotta have the stock on the shelves. And with the way they're moving to central bank digital currencies and social credit score systems and a global economic reset and the devaluing of the dollar, Russia, China is getting everybody on their team, Central Asia, I mean, Africa, they got Africa on lock. You know, they are, you know, basically excluding America. You know, they're going to have all the resources, all the countries, they have all the resources at their disposal. And they're going to say, well, who needs America? You know, we got Turkey, we got Iran, we got Saudi Arabia, we got Russia, we got China, we got the Central Asian countries, we got the Asian countries, we got Brazil, you got South Africa, you got all these countries that are kind of like, you know, indebted or, you know, on the same team as the BRICS. And I just see America as a sinking ship. And for those that are in America, they got to understand that starvation and hunger is real. And in Africa, we know that people that are poor, they live in shacks in little tents, and they don't have nothing to eat. Like, they call them favelas, or you can call them whatever you want to call them. You know, you see the same similar things in Haiti, but in Ghana, just basically like a shed. People are living just like a shed, maybe not even a shed, but you know, you have to ask yourself, why aren't these people eating? You know, the first thing is to say they're poor. And why are they poor? Well, poverty is defined as somebody that doesn't have any money to be able to buy the things that they need to buy. But then you say, well, do these people have a farm? Do they have the ability to feed themselves? And you say, well, look at where they stay at. They're all crammed up together in this area with no formal address, no electricity, no formal running water. And you say, well, Africa's a vast land. It's vast. I mean, I drove from South Africa to Swaziland. It took 3 hours. And as on the drive there, I just seen land. I just seen land after land after land after land. I mean, I seen some cows here and there, but I didn't see people on the land. I just saw land. And I'm sure and even in Ghana, the same thing, driving from across the Cape Coast, it was just land. And when we went to go look at some of the land that they were proposing to offer to diasporans to move back and get land, the chiefs have all this land. It's land, it's like acres upon acres of land, and nobody's doing nothing with it. It's land, and it's like 80 something degrees all year round. So you can pretty much plant and harvest two or three times a year. But the problem is the Europeans have done a huge disservice to Africa, to where everybody wants to be westernized. Everybody wants to go to the grocery store. They want to go to the frozen section. They want to go to get your juices, they get your meats, and you can look at your meats, you look at your lamb chops, you look at all the stuff, and you get your produce right here. It's convenient. It's convenient food. And you pay for your food, you check out, you pay for the bags. In Africa, you got to pay for the bags. It's not like in America, you get bags for free. You got to pay for your bags. And man, we have, Africa is the land of milk and honey. Africa, you know, if you want to be able to eat and have land and sustain yourself and have some boreholes and have a well and have some 10,000 liter potty tanks, have solar panels, and you know, if you live near a lake or a stream, then you can fish, or you can use some of that for hydroelectric power. You know, you can get some goats and chickens and some sheep and maybe some cows, and you can live off the land easy. And you don't have to do much to the land, because the land is not defiled like in America. You know, I live in a house with, you know, like a little gate, wall, whatever. And there's like tomatoes and lemons and limes just growing naturally in my backyard. I'm not doing anything. I didn't do anything. I'm just walking outside. There's tomatoes back there and lime. And so, you know, the people here, they grew up, their grandparents grew up plowing, building a trough with a donkey to pull to create the groove, and they drop the seeds in, and then you harvest these things. And so I think that in America, unless you want to starve, or unless you want to fight like the Hunger Games or the Walking Dead, and be always on guard and be nervous, you know, you need to start planning and preparing how you can get out of America and figure out which country you can get that visa, permanent residence, the easiest and the quickest, and then get some other people that are like-minded that also see the signs of the times, and they ain't looking to stay around, because it's going to be hell on earth in America when the dollar collapses, when things start going haywire and there's food shortages and inflation. And I'm sure you guys, you might not see what's happening in Lebanon. In Lebanon, they're telling people they can't withdraw money from the bank for like 3 days. And people are starving. And in China, you know, if you don't have your QR code green light, then you can't get in. You can't even get into your place of residency. So people are, you know, literally sleeping outside. You know, they're starving, they get frustrated, they're rioting because the government has set these draconian measures to where people can't even have access to the grocery store. But, you know, we should not be dependent on the grocery store if we know that this is where it's headed. The system is set up for control. We control your money, control how you get money, how you use money, programmable money, like food stamps. You know, like in America, you can only use WIC on formula and Pampers and baby food, and you can only use food stamps on food. And you know, we know how to do some tricks and get cash with the errors. But this is where America is headed, and people have to understand that your family, do you want to starve or do you want to live? And so people have to pay attention to the signs of the times and really look at that and say, okay, how long do I got? How long do I got? 10 years? I got 20 years? People right now in America are trying to buy houses with 30-year mortgages with interest rates 6, 7, 8%, and they're rising. You know, it's like, come on, man. Like, do you really want to do that? Do you really want to do that? You know, so some people just ain't going to see it, but I would say 5 years tops, less than that, I think. I mean, it's, those that stayed in America longer than 5 years, it may be too late.
Interesting. Very interesting. Any other questions for Ron before we move on? No other questions. We're gonna circle it back around to you. And when I ask the brothers of Tanzania questions, you can interject too anytime you want to, Brother Ron. All right, so moving on to my brothers in Tanzania, man, what's popping? Shalawan, what's going on with y'all, man? You know what I mean? See y'all out there working.
Shalawan.
Already, man. Already. It's a blessing, man, to have y'all on here and just for us to be working together, you know, doing the work together and things like that. You know, so much work to be done. You know, talking about South Africa, now we're talking about East Africa, you know. Tell the world, you know, about y'all experience living in Tanzania. Tell the world that, hey, it's life out here. You know what I'm saying? Tell the world about Tanzania.
First off, I just want to say all praises to the Most High. I also want to thank y'all for inviting us onto the platform tonight. I also want to thank Brother Dalton for his for providing us with the info that he did. Being over here in Tanzania, man, it's a nice thing. It's good. I also agree too with some of the things that you all were bringing out when you was talking about how you got brothers and sisters over here, Bantu brothers and sisters over here, where they keep certain customs that we can read in the scriptures. You know, one that stands out to me personally is where they have a law of jubilee concerning the land, you know, where you got 50 years, you know what I'm saying? You can buy some land, but it's a 50-year contract on the land. To that 50th year, you got to, hey, return it back to the, you know, the owner. So, you know, that's one that really stands out. And that's in most African countries when you look around, you know. I just wanted to put that out there. I mean, if any of the other brothers have anything to say, they can go ahead. And I'll just, you know.
Yeah, that is interesting. Very interesting. They have a 50-year, they have a jubilee year for the land. Because you can for a foreigner to own the land. You know what I'm saying? It's very, very interesting.
Yeah. They don't call it a jubilee.
Yeah.
They don't call it that, but we can read in the scriptures and understand that that's what it is.
Exactly. Yeah. Mm-hmm. They keep in tradition, not even knowing. And I just want to say this. Bantus, majority, 90% of them do not even know that they're Israelites. You know what I'm saying? They know that they keep traditions and things like that, but a lot of them don't even know they're Israelites. They don't literally, they don't know that for real. You know what I'm saying? And it's interesting.
Another thing, Palau, too, we was just discussing the other day, we was looking at how the Swahili people over here where we are, because we over here in Tanzania, where, you know, the predominant language is Swahili. And brother Dalton was saying how it'd be beef between tribes because of, you know, they split, but they speak the same language. Well, over here in Tanzania, it's not like that. They pretty peaceful over here because they deal with the Swahili and they all call themselves Swahili people, no matter what tribe you come from. But what I will say, is, you know, when it comes to the language, it's crazy because we was just talking about it the other day, man. They tell time over here like they did in ancient Israel. When you go into the book of Acts and you look at Acts 3:1, and it talks about how they prayed on the ninth hour and things of that sort. Man, when you go into the time over here, it's the same thing. You know, they still telling time the same way. You know, so yeah, you know, when you look at the customs of the people, you can actually see who they are through the customs. You know,
that's interesting. And Swahili, just let the people know, Swahili is ain't nothing but a Bantu language mixed with Arabic. Okay, so Bantu mixed with Arabic, and you bring that together, and that's what you get the Swahili language for. And it was created for them to trade with the Arabics, and the Arabic, the Arabians to trade. To trade with the Bantus people, those in those areas, you know. Mm-hmm. Very interesting, man. What about you, brother? Adewam, what you got? What you got, man?
I mean, you know, one thing that come to mind is Leviticus 19:9-10, where it talked about, you know, when we was to plant our vineyards and everything, and our, you know, everything that we planted. We wasn't supposed to glean everything. We were supposed to leave the corners for the poor and the strangers that will come by, that they can have food. And you can see that custom over here. So no matter where you go, if you see a person who has like crops or, you know, fruit trees and things like that, they'll have them on the inside of their yards, on the inside of their wall, but they'll also have some on the outside. So that, you know, passerbys can come by if they hungry and they can be able to glean and eat also. So that's one custom I know that's biblical, that, you know, whether they know it or not, that they actually keep it. Now, as far as the interaction with the people here, it's crazy because that takes me to Matthew 9:37, where, you know, Christ said that the laborers are, well, the harvest is truly plenteous, but the laborers are few. And over here in Africa, the harvest is truly plenteous. Now I can speak for East Africa where we are, you know, because that's, you know, that's where we are and that's what I know now. You know, you got the people split up into two groups. You have the Catholics and you have the Muslims. Now I can say Christians, but the reason why I'm saying Catholic, you know, particularly, is because you see all of these white images of Christ all over the place. I mean, on the back of bajajis, on the back of buses, you know, on people's cars, Uber cars and everything. And in some cases, they might have two pictures. And I'm thinking like, wow, these, you know, our people over here really, really been brainwashed to believe that, you know, another people was actually, you know, the people that they are. You know, so I mean, that's like I said, the work is really, really plenteous over here, you know. But I mean, like you said, they keep a lot of the biblical customs without even knowing, you know. So the culture is closely related to the biblical culture that we see, but it's just that the people just don't realize that they are actually the people. And you say 80 to 90% of the people here has to be Israelites, you know.
Yeah, like a huge number. Definitely, that is definitely true. I want to read something real quick. This is Matthew chapter 10. I'm gonna read verse verse 5 through 7. And it reads, the 12, Jesus or Yashaya or Yeshua, people want to call him, the 12 that Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, go not into the way of the Gentiles and into the city of the Samaritans and to ye not, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As ye go preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. All right. So the first mindset we should have, you know, as believers and want to wake our people with the gospel of Christ, we should want to go to where a lot of our people at. Not saying neglect the Gentiles. Yeah, we're gonna spread the word to them too. But first we gotta go there first. Set our foot there. And then by doing that, we able to spread to the Gentiles too. You know, I'm gonna go to this Matthew chapter 28. In this verse 18 through 20. And Jesus came, and Yashaya came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things, whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. So we go to the lost sheep, and we go to everybody else. You know what I'm saying? Jews first, then to the Gentiles. Jews first, then to the Greek. You know what I'm saying? We do that, you know, but bringing it back to Israel, I just want to read this one thing. This Isaiah 1 and verse 3. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 3. The ox knoweth his owner, and the donkey know his master crib. But Israel don't know. My people do not consider. So we need to go to the places where our people do not consider, what the Most High people do not consider who they are. They don't know who they are, you know. And this is a part of the gospel. You can't preach Christ without preaching who the Israelites is. You can't preach the Israelites without preaching about the true gospel of Christ. You know, it go hands in hand. You know what I mean? And Africa need it. They need it. Our people need it. You know, 144,000 is important to teach who these people are, to wake these people up. You know what I'm saying?
I got something I wanted to say real quick if you're done. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you go ahead, bro.
Pretty much on the same topic. I'm going to Isaiah 49, and I'm going to start at verse, let me see. I'm going to start at verse 6. It says, and he said, it is a light thing that thou shouldest be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved of Israel. I will also give thee for a light to the Gentiles, that thou mayest be my salvation until the end of the earth. So just like y'all were saying, you know, it's important that we find out who the Israelites are and teach them. Because another thing, just like y'all said, the harvest is plenty, but the laborers are few. So we have to wake up laborers. That way they can actually help us with the rest of the harvest until eventually we guys mean laborers as possible. You know, those who are in Christ's hand that can't be plucked out, right? And with the Bantu situation, like you said, Brother Pala, a lot of these people don't even know who they are. They have no idea that they have a high calling because they're actually the children of God. And with them being the children of God, they have a certain prophecy that they have to fulfill, which is not only, you know, following the law, statutes, commandments, but also gaining their inheritance, their rightful inheritance and righteousness under Christ and bringing the law through the world and teaching the Gentiles as well. Then I got something else I want to go to real quick. This is one second. I'm in Zephaniah 2:1-2. It says, gather yourselves together. Yea, gather together, O nation not desired, before the decree bring forth, before the day pass as the chaff, before the fierce anger of the Most High come upon you, before the day of the Lord's anger come upon you. So it's pivotal at this point, especially like in the day and age that we are now with everything going on. You know, wickedness is at an all-time high in every society under the heaven. So it's important that we gather ourselves together. And like y'all said, find brothers and sisters that's of like mind. And even if you can't, you know, make it out of Babylon or make it out of America, we have to strive for perfection no matter where we at. That way we can at least receive that crown when our King Christ come back. You know what I'm saying? let me go with this one real quick. Zephaniah 3 and 8 through 11. And this is showing that it's definitely Israelites within the interiors of Africa, right? And we saying that those Israelites are known as Bantus, Igbos, Yoruba, Ashanti, and many other tribes, just like Brother Ron Dalton stated. The list goes on and on and on. You have about over 200 quote unquote ethnic groups within the land of Africa itself, within the continent of Africa. But it says, therefore, wait ye upon me, saith the Lord, until the day that I rise up to the prey. For my determination is to gather the nations that they may assemble the kingdoms, to pour upon them my indignation, even all my fierce anger, for all the earth shall be devoured with the fire of my jealousy. For then I will turn to my people a pure language, that they may all call upon the name of the Lord to serve him with one consent. And hey, that's another thing I find funny, because y'all talking about the Bantu language and how it's so many different variations of it, right? That's even a little bit more proof that the Bantus are Israelites. The fact that they got one evidently mother language, but then it's a split to where it becomes many different varieties of the same language, basically. Hold on, let me finish those last two verses real quick. Verse 10, it says, from beyond the rivers of Ethiopia, my suppliant, even the daughter of my dispersed, shall bring my offering, and that day shall thou not be ashamed for all thy doings wherein thou hast transgressed against me. For then I will take away out of the midst of thee them that rejoice in thy pride, and thou shalt no more be haughty because of my holy mountain. So eventually the Most High is going to bring his people, the Bantus, no matter where you at, eventually, if you follow his law, statutes, commandments, and you put forth an effort, and you put forth effort into, you know, following the Most High, he will get you into his kingdom eventually. But notice that it says, from beyond the rivers of Ethiopia, the daughters of my dispersed, the daughters of my suppliant, even the daughters of my dispersed. So we know the river of Ethiopia, which is the Nile, the Nile has two tributaries. You got the blue Nile, you got the white Nile, and they merge together and become just what we know today, the average person, as the Nile. But when you look at the Nile River, it makes like a J almost. But although it doesn't go to the left, it goes to the right and it emptied out into the Eritrean Sea. So when you go beyond the river of Ethiopia, that's all of Africa. That means if you go to the west of the Nile, it's Israelites or Bantus in that direction. If you go to the south of the Nile, it's Bantus and Israelites in that direction. If you go southwest, it's Bantus and Israelites. So just like Brother Ryan Dutton was saying, the continent of Africa is plenteous when it comes to Africans, Bantus and Israelites.
Right on, bro. Right on. All right, so we're gonna have to do a part two, man. Cause I know we're gonna learn some more information as time go by. We're gonna have to do part two, maybe a part three, and some other stuff too. You know what I'm saying? So definitely, man. I wanna bring out this one thing. I brought out this book before. It's a real interesting book, and I encourage every brother in America to get this book, Bantu Hebrew Israelites Identity Revealed. All right, and this Kikuyu wrote this book. His name is Thomas T. Guru or something. That's how you say his name. Might be pronouncing it wrong, but I'm gonna read an excerpt out of him. And this is on page 86, and it say, it is in the record. And it is in records. This I can prove it. It is in record that the enemies, the Romans, pursued the Jews to Egypt, and they continued into the inland of Africa, where the Romans had no power. In Africa, some disappeared north to the countries what they're called Maghreb. This being the Atlas Mountains that Jesus advised them. Others went south towards Ethiopia, Sudan, and beyond. Others disappeared west across the Sahara all the way to West Africa. Now, this is actually when Christ said go to the mountains, it was actually a twofold thing, because his church, they went to Pella. They fled to the mountains, they actually went to Pella, okay? And then you had the rest of the Jews who wasn't part of Christ's church, the Jews, regular Jews, who wasn't Judean Christians, they fled to the mountains, to the Atlas Mountains. Majority of them actually went into North Africa, you know, around, this is around early second century, late first century. You know, we started migrating to North Africa, you know, and it's history on this of emperors, like an emperor named Emperor Hadrian. All right. He knew that it was a bunch of Jews living in North Africa that went out there from 70 AD. And he actually told them to come back, or I'm gonna build a temple in North Africa for y'all. And they like, nah, they're building it in Jerusalem. So Jordan came back to Jerusalem. And this is in the early second century. All right, so, but with that being said, after all that, 135 AD, we went to North Africa. Majority of us went to North Africa and some other places around Asia Minor, but it's recorded in history that we went to North Africa. A lot of us, millions of us. And then from North Africa, West Africa to Nigeria, Cameroon area. Then from there, we kept migrating. Some of us stayed around those areas. Some of us kept migrating to Congo. Then from the Congo, some of us stayed in those areas. Then some of us migrated to South Africa, to East Africa, the Bantu migration. And just in a small synopsis with it, that's the Bantu migration. All right, so, but we don't, if any other comments or questions or anything, man, from anybody, you know, any questions for Brother Ron Dalton, anything you want to say, bro?
If you don't mind, I got a couple scriptures, if you don't mind.
Yeah, do your thing, bro. Yeah.
Okay. I just want to talk to the people real quick, just for a second. Because it's a lot of people who torn between, like, hey, should I roll out? Should I just stay and wait on? You know what I mean? And I want to talk to those people because, you know, one thing we must do is, you know, the scriptures tell us that we must obey God rather than men, you know? And a lot of times what happens is, a lot of times what will happen is, you know, people will begin to believe, you know, men over, you know, the Most High. So real quick, if you don't mind, let me read this. And I just want to put this back into people's mind. This is Jeremiah chapter 17 and verse 5. It says, thus saith the Most High, cursed be the man that trusteth the man and make flesh his arm, and whose heart departeth from the Most High. Right? The heart, as we understand, is the mind. So when your mind begin to depart from the Most High and you begin to trust in man, you're going off, you know? Now, the Most High gave us specific instructions on what we to do in these last days when we begin to watch and pray and we see certain things, prophecies begin to unfold, right? So, and one of those things, let me go to Jeremiah chapter 4 and verse 5. Jeremiah chapter 4 and verse 5, it says, declare ye in Judah and publish in Jerusalem and say, blow ye the trumpet in the land, cry, gather together, and say, assemble yourselves and let us go into the defense cities. You see, so you know, the places in which we reside in these last days are getting ready to be under attack, and they are under attack as we speak. So the Most High is telling us to go into the defense cities. Now the next scripture, let me read it here. It says, set up the standard toward Zion and retire, stay not. For I will bring evil from the north and a great destruction. So when you read that, set up the standard, and certain, and like older versions, when you go into the Septuagint and things of that sort, it says, gather up your wares and go and leave. You know what I mean? So gather up your belongings or whatever you got or whatever you've obtained that'll sustain you and get up out of there. You know, this is what the word is telling us to do. So we ought to obey God rather than man. So if it's any brothers and sisters out there, if you may have a means to be able to, you know, roll out, you know, the Most High may be speaking to you through scriptures and telling you to get up out of there, man. Because who knows if you're going to have an opportunity to do it next week, 2 months from now, 3 months from now. You know, so that's just my that I wanted to do for brothers and sisters.
Is he freezing on y'all end?
Yeah. Nah, he good. Hey, I heard him though.
Brother Knight, Can you say that last part again real quick?
What was that that you didn't hear?
Like the very last part of it. I don't know if everybody else heard it or not. I'm not sure. It sounded like you was like freezing at one point.
Okay. I'm sorry about that. I just wanted to let brothers and sisters know that or bring those scriptures out for brothers and sisters.
Yeah.
That's all I said.
That's profound. You know what I'm saying? And it links with the scripture that Anaya had brought out in Jeremiah about, you know, making our way and then, you know, doing the work, you know, because that's what it essentially is, doing the work and then making our way towards Zion. You know what I'm saying? But and that's very, very interesting, man. Very, very interesting. Now, I would love if we could do a part two with this and come back and bring some more information. You know what I'm saying? Maybe in the part three, bring some more information. And I know there's some other stuff we want to go into with Ron Dawson, you know, too, and things like that too. So, you know, we're gonna keep building with this, man. If we all can do that, that'd be great. You know what I'm saying? We keep building with this over time and keep bringing more information. You know what I'm saying? We out here, foots on the ground. And I think this would be a good, you know, thing we should do from time to time, you know? But yeah, man, you know, any other things y'all want to bring out before we end this podcast segment?
Well, yeah, I wanted to ask Brother Ryan, because I know in the beginning, because I've been following him, you know, his work for probably like since maybe 2018, maybe, no, about, yeah, 2017, 18. And so, you know, I know about a year ago, maybe 2 years ago, you know, you were really saying, you know, looking at going into Ghana. And so what was it that prompted you to go into South Africa instead?
The mandates, one thing. I mean, I think everything happens for a reason. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't a coincidence. Some of the stuff that happened in Ghana, I'll disclose that later. You know, I'm not one to call out and just spill tea, like they say, but, you know, because at the end of the day, we do a lot of spilling tea on each other as Black people. And it just kind of, you know, it's kind of discouraging when people spill tea on certain things when really at the end of the day, well, we can move to the continent to various points. We can go to Ghana, we can go to Nigeria, Tanzania, Rwanda, South Africa. You know, as long as you're out of America, that's a good thing. But the mandates, I think a month after we got back, they issued the mandates, and I was like, no, I ain't doing this. Like, bump that, you know. And they didn't actually reverse the mandates or ease up on the mandates until not too long ago, at least from what I heard. So I was like, I'm not waiting all day to wait for Ghana to say on the news, okay, you don't need the vaccine or the flight to Ghana. You know, I didn't want to wait that long. And I believe that was for a reason that we was deterred to South Africa. And I thought about Cameroon, but then I know my wife, and when you got a wife and you got kids, you know, I've seen Israelites that have moved to Africa, and when they got there, their wives were like, this is not what I signed up for. I didn't know it was going to be like this. And if your wife is from the city, like Philadelphia, New York, Detroit, Chicago, and then you take them to the rural parts of Uganda, and she's used to, you know, going to the mall and hanging out with her friends, and you know, you see, it's a different thing when you grow up in the city. Even if you grow up in the country, like Atlanta or Miami or anywhere, you know, taking them to another continent is one thing, because then now a lot of things they're used to in America, they're not going to have in Africa. You know, you're not going to easily get the things, you know, like beauty supply stores, you're not going to find that where you can get all the different greases and brushes and things that you need that you normally would just go to the beauty supply store in America and get. Amazon is not going to deliver stuff to your front door over here in Africa. And certain things at the grocery store that you used to get for the kids or for yourself in America, you're going to have to choose a different selection. You know, this is what it is. You know, if your kids are used to Minute Maid fruit punch, you're not going to get Minute Maid fruit punch out here. You know, certain things that you just got to accept. So for me, when I went to Ghana, I could live in Ghana. I mean, Ghana is not bad. But when I brought my family, my wife, to South Africa, and I seen some things that South Africa had, I said, okay, my wife should not have a lot of complaints here. I'm gonna transition her nice and slow to living in Africa, period. And she's seen the good parts of South Africa, and she's seen the bad parts. So she appreciates, you know, what we have had in America thus far. But she understands by visiting places in Africa, South Africa, where people are less fortunate and are in poverty, that she's more grateful now for the things that we even have right now in South Africa. And I just see the coming here, and she's when we came here initially, she did complain. She complained, and I knew she was gonna complain. She complained a lot. You know, this is what I'm talking about. You know, I want to go home. You know, you're gonna, when somebody gets mad, they're gonna say, "I want to go home." You know, this is not what I signed up for. Wow, you mean to tell me I can't get this? You mean to tell me my kids can't get this? You mean to tell me this? They don't have red hot sauce. They don't have Lowry seasoned salt. They don't have this. They don't have that. You know, it's a lot of things. They don't have certain types of cereal for the kids. You know, they don't have beef hot dogs. It's hard to find beef hot dogs here for the kids. You know, all these different things. Like you say, well, you know, just relax. We're going to make do. We're going to try to find an alternative. And by finding alternatives and seeing that at the end of the day, we're eating, our children are eating, they're getting fed, they got a roof over their head. They got Wi-Fi, and Wi-Fi is strong enough so that they can stream my little tablets, and they can you know, watch Netflix or something. You know, these are things that I'm happy because it lessens the amount of complaining that you might get in the beginning. And once your spouse deals with the power outages, the load shedding, the water outages, just, you know, the language barrier, because even though they speak English here, it's a different English. So I can understand Nigerians, I can understand Ghanaians, I can understand anybody in Africa that's speaking English. In Jamaica, however, when Jamaicans, they had that thick accent and they had that the Jamaican slang, they could be speaking English. I'm like, what? What did you just say? You know, but in Africa, I can understand all of the people in Africa that speak English. But my wife might have to listen and be like, I don't understand what they're saying. Like, can you just order for me? Because I'm getting frustrated, you know. And in America, they say Americans talk fast. They say we talk fast, and then our English is different than United Kingdom English. But I think it's a good thing that I came here instead of Ghana, because if I went to Ghana, especially Cape Coast, and if I told my wife, okay, this is worth staying in Cape Coast. Cape Coast is a lot different than Accra. Accra, she might have liked Accra, but Accra has its issues too. But if I took my wife to Ghana, Cape Coast, or Accra, she might have been complaining a lot, a whole lot. And a happy wife is a happy life. And the goal is to bring your whole family to Africa and not have your wife say, I'm not going. You want to go? Then we're gonna have to get a divorce, and the kids are staying with me. You know, I know brothers that are divorcing their wives, and their kids are still in America because they're like, you know, I'm gonna get out of here. My wife's not feeling it. She's her mother is talking her ear. She wants the kids to be in these public schools, and they ain't teaching them nothing, and they're trying to push these vaccines. And so you really, if you got a family and kids, You really have to be careful where you're going to take them to, so that you don't end up, you know, the wife saying, okay, I'm going home with or without you. What you're going to do, you know? And so South Africa was perfect in the Most High planned it right so that my wife can actually accept that Africa is better than America, and that she does not miss America, and that she does, she can see herself staying in Africa, and the kids are going to school here, or homeschooling the kids here, and just we're just living a different chapter of our life now in our 40s. So you know, that even though at the time I thought about the reason why we left, we didn't decide to go to Ghana because of the mandates, because that ultimately was the reason why initially. But when I look at it now in retrospect, I see that if we went to Ghana, my wife should have been saying like, I want to go home. You know, especially if I brought it to Cape Coast. But yeah, so we're here now, and I have a lot of different dreams and visions and goals, and places also I want to travel to in Africa, including Tanzania, because I keep seeing videos about Tanzania, and I got to get down there, and first I got to get my long-term visa secure here so that I don't have to sweat bullets about the 90 days and renewing and all sort of stuff. And I can just say, okay, we here now, so now I can just get a plane ticket and fly to Tanzania. Tanzania, I don't know how you pronounce it, but yeah, so everything happens for a reason, and the Most High works things out, so, you know, it is what it is.
That's a blessing, though, man. I see the sister had just got on here. We're gonna wrap it up, but I do want the sister to speak. I think there's your people, though, Ron, the sister, the Bantu sister.
Yeah, she's Kisi Abugusi from Kenya.
She's Kisi.
Yeah, Kisi, yeah. She knows all about the Israelites, and she can connect her tribe to the Israelites' language, Hebrew, Egyptian. She's a scholar. She's a scholar.
Okay. Well, sis, habariyako.
You got to unmute, Bosi.
I don't know. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Can you give the people we're gonna wrap it up, but I do want to hear your can you give the people an explanation on how do you know that you are an Israelite? How do you know that?
Okay. How do I know? All right. So I'm driving. I hope you guys can hear me. Can you hear me?
Yes. Yeah, we can hear you very well.
Okay. All right. So my name is Bosibori Bonge. Just like Ron said, I'm from Kenya, East Africa, and I'm from the Abagusi tribe. That's in Western Kenya. Now, the reasons why I believe, and beyond a doubt, and no one can convince me I'm not a Hebrew, is because initially, this started first, it was a spiritual thing. I had a dream, and then somehow the elders held a meeting just to let us know that we shouldn't forget our royal lineage that's attached to Egypt and further beyond Egypt. That's all they say. They said, you know, just we came from Italy. And usually when the elders hold a meeting like that, if you don't get it, you won't get it. Usually they've never come forth and said something like that in public. So that to me had me asking questions. And what else? Okay, yeah. So then I decided after I had the dream and I was told the dream pretty much just said the answer is in culture. I didn't know what that meant at the time, because my interest has always been cultural, but I just wasn't sure what the dream meant. So then I started to have revelations about, you know, etymology, to go and look at words. So when I went and started to look at the words, because if people say, okay, so if the family says that we come from Egypt and further beyond Egypt, and that we were once slaves in Egypt, somehow that had me asking questions. Who else was slaves in Egypt, you know? All right. So to be able to establish a migration pattern, I had to use comparative linguistics. to be able to determine this. And I just started with a simple ceremony, which is a circumcision ceremony that every man has to go through in a Bagosi culture. And the ceremony is called Iburu, okay? Or to become Hebrew, basically. It's called Iburu. Iburu in my language means to cross over or pass over. And modern Hebrew or Ivrit, it means exactly the same, to cross over or pass over. And then the things, you know, people who speak a certain language or culture don't change, because language is not just language. It's an emblem of social behavior. So I looked at the names for God, okay? Now, in Hebrew, God is called El, E-L. Now, in my language, there's many other names, but one of his attributes, especially as a warrior, is El, but it's pronounced Eri, because we do not have the letter L, okay? And in Bantu languages, R and L are usually interchangeable. So Eri, El, mean exactly the same. It's a bull, it's a leader, it's a chief, it's a king, it's a preponderant one, exactly like the Hebrew definition is. And then when you come on over, when you look at the Bagusi, our cousins, people who are cousins to us, we call them Ba Moabo, meaning the people of Moab. So that's the word we use for cousin. Okay, it's a plural term, but it can be used in a singular form. Okay, so if you look in Aramaic, the word for Moabite is Mu'abba. For us, it's Mu'abbo. Okay, now if you look back in the Bible, Israel and basically the children of Israel and the children of Lot were basically cousins. Okay, were basically cousins. So that's why we are Bagusi, when you become an Iburu, okay, through, you know, the circumcision ceremony. Also, I'm sorry, hang on, getting distracted. Mm-hmm. Okay, during the circumcision ceremony, they do let you know the tribes that you can marry into and those that you can't marry into. And especially the Hamitic tribes, we don't really marry into Hamitic tribes unless we're dying out, okay? Then when you move over to the name, the second letter of the Hebrew alphabet, okay, the first one is L, the second one is Beit, okay? Now we have Beit. Beit in Hebrew means members of the household, you know, or the house. Now, when you come to ancient Egyptian, Beit is a house. Beit is a house. But in Swahili, Baiti is a house. In Ekegusi, Vaito are members of the household or a house. And in Kimeru, the word for somebody who's a member of the household is Vaite. So they take the V part. So Bet. Okay, so yeah. And this led me, okay, further into researching the Hebrew, you know, alphabet, because that's the most fundamental, should I say, part of the language, the alphabet. And I did get to do some rooms, I guess, with Brother Ron, where we are breaking down the meaning of the Hebrew letters together with the Bantu Swahili and the Bantu Kegusi, together with Sister Reseram from West Africa. She also has her rendition of the same. And my studies have shown me that the ancient Egyptian Bantu and the Congo Niger languages is together with Hebrew, because why would these people call God El? Members of the household are called Beit, you know, which sometimes can be called Batu or Banto. That's also a phonetic variation of the name Beit. You see, that got me asking questions. Like, then when you look at Swahili, the word for mankind is Bin Adam. Okay, Bin Adam, just like Arabic and just like Hebrew and Turkish, all right? Now, here's the thing. Usually people will say, oh, Swahili has been brought by the Arabs, so Bin Adam is an Arabic word. Now, I argue, no, it's not, because the way Bin Adam is used is different from the way Mtu or Watu, people, is used, okay? Number two, the word Bin is a Bantu name, meaning son of or child. In a Kegusi culture, children are called Bana. In Hebrew, son is called Ben. Okay, so, and then you find within Kikuyu, they'll say Shana for children. So this word is used all over Africa. So this word bin cannot be of Semitic origin, just like the word Adam. The word Adam in Swahili, Damu means blood. But you'll find that in the Nimbari language, you have the word Dem as well, meaning blood. So they like to say it's Semitic, but when you look at correlating Bantu languages, you'll find all those biblical names. And if you look at my, you know, Hebrews to Negroes, my YouTube channel, I break them down, you know, biblical names, you know, and they're really not that much different from the Bible using Bantu.
All right. I hope that. Yeah, that was a lot. You know, it was interesting about the elders meeting you talked about, and interesting about you comparing the languages, the Bantu language to the Hebrew language. Very, very interesting insight, you know, and then talking about the circumcision, you know, very, very interesting insight. I hope the brothers and sisters, the listeners, you know, absorb that information.
Can she get the name of her YouTube?
Yeah, I'm gonna ask about the get them to do that. If Brother Dalton and the Kissy sister, my Kissy sister, if y'all can give y'all, you know, information out there, and hopefully we can come on and do this again in the next month or so, you know, do a part two and bring some more information, and you know, we can do this, you know, every often, you know, and keep doing this, man, because it's very, very much needed, and this is part of the work we can do. So yeah, if you can, Brother Dawson, give us your information where people can find you at, people can, you know, check out your things and everything like that.
Yeah, so I'm just putting something in the chat. Aside from YouTube, his YouTube name is Hebrews to Negroes TV, aka Moses Levi. And then Instagram is Hebrews underscore T-O underscore Negroes, N-E-G-R-O-E-S. Some people, they just do R-O-S. So it's N-E-G-R-O-E-S. And then I have Hebrews to Negroes TV, which functions like Vudu, which is like video on demand, or Amazon, where you have to buy or rent a movie or whatever it is you got going on, a short. It could be anything. I mean, if it's 30 minutes to an hour, you can rent, you can buy, or you can put it on the subscription-based platform where subscribers only have access to it, and you can even put it on there for free. For free. You can mute her, yeah, for free. So that anybody that goes on the app can see some free stuff. And then if they like it, after say watching like two or three episodes, and then the other episodes are subscriber based, or they have to buy the whole episode or the season, and then it'll prompt them. Like if you want to see more, then you gotta subscribe, or you gotta, you know, pay. And so this is a way that we don't have to let YouTube pimp us and use us, and we don't get nothing out of it in return in terms of marketing and advertising and getting people to know that our channel and our content actually exists. Because there's a lot of Israelites that are putting our YouTube videos, whether they're African-based or not, whether they're in Africa or not, and they're not getting the advertising and marketing that a large camp like IUIC or GOCC or anybody would normally push. And so therefore they have a small following and not a lot of people get to see their videos, and they can have good content. There's not a lot of people seeing what they're doing in Africa and the positive things that's being shown on the video. And so with H2N TV, I encourage music artists, filmmakers, content creators, you know, people just, you know, nowadays you can, with iPhone 11, 12, 13, 14, if you're out in the Uber, or if you're out in the field, or out, you know, just out and about in Africa, you hold your phone like this, or if you have a GoPro And the GoPros nowadays, they got like a little chest harness strap that you can put it like right here. And you can kind of like, if it's cool, or if you just want to just walk around with a harness, if people ain't gonna say nothing, you could be literally walking with your GoPro right here, and it's capturing everything that you're doing. And or you can have a DJI, you can have an actual camera or a camera guy and record everything that you're doing. Because nowadays reality TV and content creation is what people like to see. They like to follow people that they enjoy their content, and they're actually considering moving to the continent. And if you guys are in Tanzania or Kenya or Egypt or wherever, they may want to also link up with you guys if they fly to these areas, because a lot of the tours that are going to Tanzania may be Black tours, but they're not Hebraic based. They're coming to Tanzania just to see the Zanzibar Island and Serengeti and you know, be with the Maasai. They don't have no concept of what's going on in the world. The Hebrews, the Great Awakening, Two Sticks Uniting, they don't have no clue. It's just it's like people just, you know, looking around, just, you know, okay, you know, we see the animals, we see the Maasai, we see Zanzibar, we learn the history, we're seeing it, we're in another continent that we've never been before. And then we get on a plane, go back home, go back to America. But no, we're here with a different mission, different narrative. And we're trying to encourage other African Americans and Caribbean Blacks to follow in our footsteps and become part of this family and community. And the only way people can see these things nowadays is if you have, you know, of course, you're on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and the good thing about H2N TV is that it's multiple people on there, so that somebody else's audience might stumble upon your video. And now you have somebody else from another audience that's looking at your stuff now. You know, as long as you keep the content coming, then, you know, my audience now is looking at your stuff, you know, and your audience is looking at my stuff. So everybody's kind of getting exposed to people's things. And that's the way it should be. And that's the way that music artists shouldn't just be promoted by their camp and that's it. And everybody else that's not affiliated with the camp, they have no clue who this rapper is, because he only raps under GOCC or IUIC or IGBK or Sicari. And that's it, you know, or, you know, a filmmaker or a music artist that raps is not affiliated with the camps. Nobody knows about him unless he makes himself known amongst the camps. But with H2N TV, I try to get a wide variety of Hebrews that are willing to share some of their videos on the platform, even though they might be affiliated with the camps or they used to be affiliated with the camps. And they just know that, hey, you know, I mean, I'm not a slave to the camp, but I know that I want my music to hit all the Hebrews, even those that are not in the camp, those that are in other countries. And H2N TV allows people to actually see all these Hebrew artists that are non-camp affiliated, camp affiliated, and they might not have ever heard about these Hebrews before in their whole life. You know, they could have been in California, it could have been in Jamaica, they could be in Florida, it could be in Michigan, Detroit, Chicago. And it's kind of like a way that we can really start to build and help others find out who we are, what we're doing. Because YouTube, at the end of the day, they're not promoting any of us. YouTube is not going to say with a little ad, like, hey, check out Hebrew Sneagles TV. He got a lot of good content on it. They're not going to do that. Matter of fact, YouTube is trying to censor and delete a lot of my videos that I put. You know, it could be there 1 minute, next minute, Ron, they took your video down for hate speech or whatever, you know, copyright violation. And I gotta try to fight them and all sort of stuff to get the video back up. And God forbid they take my whole channel down. Then all my videos that I didn't put out, whether they're 1 hour videos, 2 hour videos, 3 hour videos, it's all a waste now, because it's all that YouTube just made it vanish. And unless it's backed up, it could be backed up on hard drive, but then where am I gonna put it at? Who's gonna see it? So I had to create a platform to where we can not have to worry about YouTube just deleting our whole channel. And you're like, dang, well, I gotta start from scratch. What, how am I gonna do this? You know, so we gotta start thinking about leaving, or at least duplicating what we're doing on YouTube, but on another platform. So if you have two places where your videos are being seen, yeah. That's what IUIC has IUIC TV. So when IUSC comes out with a movie, they're going to put their movie, their short, on IUIC TV. You know, because they just put out a movie, I think it was like 30 minutes long, about Joseph's dream or something like that. And nobody knew about it unless you actually, you know, kind of are in the Hebrew circle, and you say, oh, they got a movie coming out. How do I see the movie? IUIC TV. Okay, that makes sense. You know, you're not going to see their movie on YouTube, you know, because they spent money on the movie and they don't want YouTube to just get free views from their movie that they spend money on. But IUIC is only IUIC. And they're not going to, and GLCC is not going to promote IUIC's movie. And ISUPK and Sakari is not going to promote IUIC's movie. And, you know, just like, you know, they might say Ron Dalton, he's not going to promote IUIC's movies because, you know, this guy might say something about Ron, and then Ron's like, I'm not dealing with this guy. So we have to, you know, find a way that we can come to a common ground and understand that we need to support one another, because although there are Hebrews in camps, some of these guys are talented artists, music artists, and they're talented filmmakers or talented content creators with the camera and the video editing. And, you know, we just need to, you know, start being more unified instead of being divided. No. So h2ntb.com is, you can get a lot of my content nowadays. Bosie's on there, her content, other sisters and brothers from the continental Africans and diasporans. And like I said in the chat, the H2N TV app is on Roku and Amazon Fire. In Africa, they have Android and iOS because people are using their phones and they buy their data. Outside of that, in South Africa, all they have for the apps is Netflix, Amazon, Showmax, and they got DSTV. That's it. You know, so if you're a filmmaker in South Africa and if you can't get your movies on Netflix or Showmax, you ain't making no money. And so Netflix, what they do is they'll have original Netflix series. And everybody in there will be South African. The producers, the directors, the writers, the location for the filming will be South Africa. But Netflix funded all the money. They pay for everything. They gave all the actors their one check. And after the movie was done, it's on Netflix, and Netflix is making buku money off of their Netflix series that's based out of South Africa. Yeah. And that's how Netflix and Showmax, they keep winning and winning and winning. And the South African filmmakers, they're not rich. They're just, yeah, you know, one check and that's it.
Yeah. Now that's very interesting, man. We definitely need to network, and we definitely down with cross promotion and networking, and that's a good platform that you got. You know, so one of the brothers actually paid for a whole year subscription the other day. So, you know what I mean, we definitely definitely agree with you saying about networking and creating our own platform, and that's good at what you're doing, for real, for real.
The brothers in Tanzania, do you guys like record the stuff you're doing with an iPhone or with a DJI or a GoPro? So that even if you gotta do it yourself, you know, if you don't have nobody to hold the camera for you, you can do it yourself and just, you know, interview people, talk to people, just kind of like give a play by play what you're doing today, what you didn't accomplish. And I mean, it could even be like a daily blog, like, okay, this is daily blog 101. Today's date is blah, blah, blah. I'm headed to the market, blah, blah, blah. And they know that you're a Hebrew because you're going to be, you know, saying Hebrew stuff. You're going to be, you know, talking, you know, they're going to know some way, somehow through your talking that you are Hebrew affiliated. And these are the kind of things that other Hebrews in America need to see, because there's other Hebrews in America that are considering moving to Tanzania. And they may not know anybody who's in Tanzania as a Hebrew that they can link up with when they get there. And all I can do is tell them, like, I'm in South Africa. I got some connects that I can link you with, like a brother or sister the other day, like 2 days ago, hit me up and say he's flying to Tanzania. Do I know any Hebrews out there? And I sent some you guys email saying hit them up because they got some people that's in Tanzania or in Kenya. So this is how we help connect others to what you're doing. And the good thing about doing videos and content creation is that now you got hundreds, if not thousands, of people that's eyeballing Yeah, okay. Benaiah is in Tanzania. Kerry Walker is in Tanzania. I saw it on Ron Dalton's H2N TV. He has in the description how to reach out to these brothers. Now they're meeting up with you. And now you might have another brother that's on the team, or a sister or a family that y'all can build with. And that's how, you know, things, that's how we really need to do things.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. Brother Benaiah, if you can get the people your information, your YouTube information. I know y'all YouTube information, we got it connected to ours, Jane, but can you give them your information they can go directly to it too?
Yeah, we got a YouTube channel. It's called Yashaya Sceptre, Royal Sceptre of Yashaya. Sorry about that. Royal Sceptre of Yashaya. So yeah, we have a YouTube channel, you know, and we put out content. Mostly we do, you know, Sabbath things, but at the same time, we have a charity ministry in which we're in conjunction with God Family Nation. And, you know, we actually do, you know, we do little videos so that way we can get donations, you know, so that would be something that we could, you know, possibly, you know, talk with you concerning, you know, putting on the H2N TV, you know, network or whatever you know, what you got going over there. I actually think that's a great idea. And I'm gonna tell you why, because, you know, that tears down some of the divisions that we all have amongst each other. Just because we don't believe the same things don't mean we ain't brothers and sisters and that we don't have the same goals towards the kingdom. You know, at some point we're going to have conversations that's not going to be comfortable amongst each other. And we're going to have to, you know, eventually figure out where we're going to go, how we're going to move forward one amongst another, you know? And I believe that what you got there is gearing us in the right direction, you know, towards that. But yeah, we do have a YouTube channel and it's called Royal Sceptre of Yashaya. And it's somebody just wrote it in the chat there. I think I see it there in the chat. Yeah.
And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna add all the links to the description to this video later on. So yeah, I mean, like I said, man, we can come back, do a part three, man. This is a real insightful conversation. And I believe we can have some more like these, you know, and everything, and we can just keep building. We can build that network, you know, we'll love to be a part of that, Jank, and build with you with that, Jank, Brother Dalton, and everything, man. And we can, you know, cross-promote, do a bunch of things, because we out here, and if we can come together and do things and make an impact, because like Brother Benaiah said, like, we got a charity ministry, man, that's one thing that we're doing out here to try to get people to see, you know what I'm saying? That is work to do out here, you know what I'm saying? And they can come help out, because it's so much work. And it's only a few laborers, you know, and we need it, you know what I'm saying? We need it. And, you know, in Africa, you know, it's a lot of scamming going on and things like that. So us doing a charity mission, we got it a certain way that we not scamming people. We actually going to these places, dealing with these people, having a pre-visit, then going back, having a whole event with these people, you know, putting the information out there, being transparent with the people, you know what I'm saying? Because even though you have scammers out here in Africa, but you do have people that's actually struggling too, you know what I'm saying? They actually need the diaspora help, you know what I'm saying? So, you know what I mean? We can get back, man. I don't want to keep prolonging this, Jane, but let's do a part two, you know what I mean? And really good information, man. Really good information. Appreciate you coming on, Brother Ron Dalton. Hope we can do this again. And I appreciate the brothers in Tanzania coming on. And I'm saying, let's just keep working towards the kingdom, man.
Hey, Pala, I was gonna say real quick. Mm-hmm. We still on?
Yeah, we still live right now about this.
Oh, I was gonna say the sister. Can she give her YouTube channel?
It's on Dalton. She's connected with Dalton. It's on it's on the Hebrews and Negroes TV. So man, that's another episode of God Family Nation. And we're gonna try to do some segments like these more often, you know what I'm saying? So, and it was very, very insightful, man. I hope everybody had a blessed edification with this, you know. Bless everybody that came on, and you know, and just let's wake up Africa. Let's wake it up, man. Let's wake Africa up. It's what got people up.
Amen.
Morning to you, man. Morning to your love. I say, Africa must wake up, you sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Yeah, now. Well, Africa must wake up, you sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today?
The black oasis, ancient Africa, the sacred awaken, the sleeping giant, science, art is your creation. I dreamt that we could visit old Kemet. Your history is too complex and rigid for some Western critics. They want the whole subject diminished, but Africa's the origin of all the world's religions. We praise bridges that carried us over the battlefronts of Sudanic soldiers, the task put before us.
You hear me out? Africa must wake up, you sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we